My name is Bastian Hofmann. At SUSE, I'm a field engineer, and I'm focusing on everything related to containers, Kubernetes, and our Ranch offerings. And today, I want to show you how you can use Rancher to manage everything from one to thousands of Kubernetes clusters. Before we go into detail into Kubernetes and Rancher, let's start with talking about containers. Containers are great. They allow you to package your applications into portable and self-contained images. And then you can take these container images and just start them wherever there's a container runtime without having to care about all the dependencies you need to install with it. The way it works is that you can package your application source code, and it doesn't matter if it's interpreted files or if it's actually compiled binaries. You can package this into a container image together with all the dependencies that your application has. And that can be the language runtime, it can be a web server, an application server, other CLI tools, libraries, and packages that your application needs in order to run. To build up such an image, you have to define how this file system, how this container image should look like. And you can do this with a so-called Docker file. It's just a file, a text file that you usually put into your Git repository alongside your code. And in this, you describe what content should be inside of the container image. And there are multiple things you can do in such a Docker file. You can base your image upon another image to not repeat yourself all the time. For example, in this Docker file that you are seeing, we are basing our image that we are building based on the Ubuntu latest image. That means we are getting a base image that looks like an Ubuntu, has the userland Ubuntu layout inside of it. Then we can add multiple labels for metadata, and we can run commands inside of the image during the build process of the image to modify our image and the file system. So in this case, for example, we are installing Apache. We can also copy additional files from our local system into the image, in this case, from locally from our system, from home user source to var3w.html. We can set a working directory, and we can configure which command inside of the image should be executed once this image is started inside of a container. And we can configure which port is going to be exposed then to the outside of the container. And you can take this file, and with a container runtime tool like Docker, you can build it and you get an image out of it. And this image, you can think of it like a tar file, like an archive of your application you can take, and then you can put it through maybe some container registry mechanism on any server, on any machine that you want that has a container runtime, and you can start it there. And the image is started inside of a container. That means the process that is started there inside of the container, in our example, the Apache process, will only see itself. The process is running natively on the system. There is no virtualization involved. But through Linux kernel features, the process doesn't see other processes on the system. It has no way to directly interact with them. And also, every container has its own file system and no direct access to the host file system. Similarly, network-wise, containers are also isolated, so to make it easier to run multiple applications, maybe even with the same ports that should be opened by multiple Apaches on the same hosts. And another great thing is, when you stop the container, the whole thing is deleted and your system is clean again. That also means updating an application is very easy. You build up a new image with your new source code and stop the old container, start the new one. Great. So containers are great. And if you have a couple of them, like 2, 3, 4, and maybe 1, 2, 3 servers, managing them is no big problem. You can just run them and stop them, and maybe you're going to build up a bit of tiny automation around that, but even doing this by hand is not so complicated. But in most systems, in most environments, you not only have 1 or 2 applications and 1 or 2 instances of each, you have multiple applications. So you have multiple containers, and not only 1, 2, 3, but maybe dozens or hundreds of them. And it's not even about only microservices and that you only have these problems in microservice architectures. You quickly also have this in smaller setups where you have additional databases, monitoring daemons, logging tools, security tools, and lots of other auxiliary helpers that you also need for your whole environment to run. And then we have lots of containers. It actually starts to get complicated because you have to decide which container should run on which server, how to set up networking in between them, how to set up security, firewalls, and you probably want to automate this. And it's fine. You can automate this. You can reinvent the wheel. You can create your own scripts. And then a couple months later, you probably can focus again on the software you actually wanted to write. Or you can have a look at what's already out there, and maybe there is a tool that solves a lot of these problems, or all of these problems for you already. And this tool is Kubernetes. Kubernetes is a container orchestration platform that you can install on your servers. Your server will form a big cluster, and then Kubernetes can help you with making all these decisions. And the great thing about Kubernetes is that it provides a common and standardized API to deploy containers, which works not only in your data center or in the cloud, but basically everywhere where you want to install software. Of course, data center and the cloud, these are very valid options, but Kubernetes can also be executed on your development laptop or your development machine for testing, and also it can be run and executed in your CI/CD pipeline or even on the edge, in factories, in stores, in 5G cell towers, in windmills, in trains, cars, planes, even in satellites in space. And the great thing with all these different environments and these different infrastructures, Kubernetes provides a standardized common API to manage your software, to manage your containers on them, to deploy them, to update them, but then also to set up things like networking, security policies, firewalls, load balancing, health checks, auto-scaling, role-based access control, service discovery, backup and disaster recovery upon it. So it solves actually a lot of hard challenging problems where, like in classical hosting environments, we probably would have spent at least some months solving them. And Kubernetes solves this in a standardized way that always looks the same. And in order to do this, and to do all this with Kubernetes, Kubernetes provides you an API. And with a declarative configuration, you can tell Kubernetes what to do and how your cluster should look like. So declaratively, you can describe your cluster. And Kubernetes does this with providing certain resources in its API. A resource can, for example, be a deployment of your applications, a service, a volume, and we are going to see a few of more of these resources and abstractions in a few moments. And then you can interact with the Kubernetes API by creating, retrieving, updating, and deleting these resources. So let's look into these resource types and the way how we can tell Kubernetes what should be running in a bit more detail. The first important resource, the first important abstraction is a pod. A pod is the smallest unit of deployment in Kubernetes. And conceptually, it's kind of similar to what a virtual machine would be in a classical hypervisor world. Each pod can contain one or more containers, and each pod is encapsulated from the rest. It can have its own storage volumes, it can have its own networking, and all containers within one pod are then scheduled always by Kubernetes on the same worker node. Networking-wise, all containers of one pod are configured to communicate with each other over localhost, and you can even share volumes. Every container, though, within a pod still has its own file system, its own image, and also the processes can't communicate directly because every process only sees itself. You only can communicate over network, over localhost. So every container is still very much self-contained. So a pod would be one instance of your application. But why would you even need more than one container for one instance of your application? The reason behind that is that it is good practice to only run one process per container to really have this encapsulated and isolated from the rest. Oftentimes, for one instance of your application, you need more than one process. It could be that you have your language runtime and then a web server. That is one instance of your application. Or you have your application binary and a monitoring daemon. That also is one instance of your application. It should always be executed together and be scheduled together. So you would have one pod with two containers, one your application, one the monitoring daemon. So pods are great. But then in a lot of applications, in a lot of scenarios, you not only want to run one instance of your application, but multiple ones. Like for high availability. Of course, you can run multiple pods, but that would mean probably creating the same pod multiple times. And if you need to update your application to a new version, you would need to create 5 new pods with version 2 of your application, and maybe then stop 5 old pods with version 1. And then you probably want to automate this somehow. Fortunately, Kubernetes already has this built in. And this is called a deployment. A deployment is another resource type in the Kubernetes API. And it's an abstraction for managing a number of identical pods. So instead of creating 5 pods, you create one deployment that contains a template of a pod. And in that, you say Kubernetes, please run this 5 times. And then Kubernetes has additional information and additional controllers inside that also help you with updating these deployments. So for example, you can say, I have this deployment, I'm running this 3 times, now I'm updating the image version to version 2, and Kubernetes automatically in the background will do and will perform a rolling upgrade of all the managed pods of the deployment, so that you have a 0 downtime deployment built in directly inside of Kubernetes. And this is how it looks like. In Kubernetes, resources are usually configured and specified as YAML files. And every resource in Kubernetes looks very similarly. You have a version of the resource. You have the kind, what it is, in this case, a deployment. You have a block of metadata and a specification. And our deployment here has a specification where it says, I want to run the pods inside of this deployment 3 times, 3 replicas. And then you have a template for each pod. And each pod template, again, has a block of metadata. And then a specification, which is a list of the containers that should run in this pod. In our example, we have one container per pod, which is in Nginx. And this is a Yeah, simple, abbreviated example, or very minimal example. You can do lots more things. You can specify health checks, environment variables, volumes, upgrade policies. There are tons of additional settings you can set here. And then, as a user, you can send this YAML file, this specification, to the Kubernetes API, and Kubernetes will then create three pods inside of your cluster and schedule them on nodes where there is space to run them. And if at any point in time one goes away because maybe a server breaks, Kubernetes will see this and without you having to do anything, will recreate the pod somewhere else. So awesome. Additionally, each of these pods has their own IP address inside of an internal Kubernetes overlay network. So by default, applications and pods running inside of Kubernetes are not exposed to the outside, but they are available within an internal Kubernetes network. And also by default, every pod can talk with every other pod, and every pod gets an IP address. But you can imagine, these IP addresses of these pods, they are quite volatile and change all the time. We just saw a pod was stopped because of whatever reason and started again, and it very likely will get a new IP address with that. Or you may decide to scale up from 3 to 5 instances and replicas. So you have not 3, but 5 IP addresses anymore. So if you have 2 applications inside of your Kubernetes cluster and application A wants to talk with application B, you need a kind of load balancer. You can roll your own, you can deploy your own, or you can have a look at what Kubernetes has to offer. And to solve that problem nicely, Kubernetes has an internal load balancing mechanism called services. With a service, you can expose an application running on a set of pods. And that means you can set up a service that load balances to all pods within a deployment, for example. And the service then gets a static IP address inside of the Kubernetes network that is always the same. And you can just connect to it and you will be load balanced to any of the pods that are currently running behind this and that they're also healthy. And each service also gets an internal DNS record to make it easily resolvable and discoverable. In addition, you can also use the service to not only create an internal load balancer, a so-called cluster IP load balancer, but then to also expose your application to the external world. Either by opening up a node port, a port on every node of your cluster, that then on the public interface of your node, that then redirects traffic inside of the cluster to the service and the pods, or by connecting it to an external load balancer, for example, an AWS load balancer or an F5 big IP, or potentially also another software load balancer that is running externally. So if we have a look at this from an architecture point of view, we have our service here that has 3 pods of a deployment as an endpoint. And if one of the pod dies and maybe is started again, and gets a different IP address, the service is automatically reconfigured. So services are great. But let's think a bit more about exposing our applications externally. Let's say we have 20 applications in our cluster, and all 20 applications should be available to the outside, to internal or external users. That means we need 20 services. And 20 times, we have to think about not only exposing it to the outside, but also doing this securely. We need to think about TLS certificates, maybe sticky sessions and a lot of other HTTP-based load balancing things that we need to actually expose something to the outside. To help us with that, Kubernetes has an additional abstraction called an ingress. So instead of having to do this 20 times and having to decide 20 times how we are going to expose something to the outside, and maybe then also having to pay 20 times for some load balancers in front of it, we can also say we only have one public endpoint, one public entry point inside of the cluster, which is called an ingress controller. That could be an Nginx, manage a proxy, traffic. There are multiple different implementations of it. And then with ingress configurations, we configure this publicly available load balancer to distribute traffic based on the HTTP host name to the internal Kubernetes services and pods. And then we have one central point that we can expose outside, one central point that cares about TLS termination, about DNS, about all the different things we need to do to expose something securely outside. And this is how it looks like. On the right side, we see again how such an ingress configuration, a routing configuration, is configured and described through a Kubernetes YAML manifest. And here we can see we are configuring our ingress controller, our Nginx, which sits at the edge of the cluster, to route all incoming traffic with the host name foo.bar.com and the path foo to service A, port 4200, and with the path bar to service B, port 8080. It's basically like name-based virtual hosting. So these are the basics and also the basic things we need to for our small Kubernetes and Rancher introduction. There are many more resources. There are config maps for and secrets for key value provided configuration storage, persistent volumes, autoscalers, cron jobs, and much more resources available. But that would go into too much detail for this presentation. So now that we understood how we can interact with Kubernetes, it's time to think about how to actually set it up and use it. And a Kubernetes cluster is in the end also a distributed system that consists of multiple components. Here on the left side, we have our user that interacts with the Kubernetes API, which is one of the Kubernetes control plane components. The Kubernetes control plane then interacts with an etcd, which is a distributed key value store that Kubernetes uses to store its current state. And then you have all the worker nodes of a Kubernetes cluster here that run your actual applications and containers, which all the time ask the Kubernetes control plane, hey, what should I run? What is the current state? What containers should I start or stop? And this Kubernetes control plane here in the middle is even simplified. It's actually also a set of small microservices that you can scale and set up independently. This is great. It's a powerful, stable, and very flexible system. But since it's distributed, all these components also have to be set up. They have to be configured in a way that works together. And since they are communicating over the network, you also have to care there about high availability, service discovery, certificates. And that is actually quite a bit of work. And you can do this by hand. There are documentations by that. This is like a very great blog post series in a Git repository from Kelsey Hightower, who talks about how to actually set up Kubernetes the hard way from scratch. You can do this. It's a great learning exercise, but you probably don't want to do this in production because you not only have to set it up, you probably also have to update it at some point, and it's much too easy to make some error that actually then can compromise security or stability of the cluster. Actually, similarly, if you just look at a single Linux, you also don't compile it from scratch. You don't start with compiling a Linux kernel. You use the distribution to help you with that and to make good decisions and make your life easier and more secure. And from SUSE Rancher, the Kubernetes distribution we are offering is called RKE, the Rancher Kubernetes Engine. With RKE, you get a 100% upstream Kubernetes without any modifications. And that Kubernetes is also certified by the Cloud Native Computing Foundation to be completely and 100% standard compliant. What RKE offers on top, it makes it very easy to install Kubernetes. It makes it very easy to install in a secure and highly available way by providing lots of sane defaults that you can still modify, of course, and change if you need to. It gives you a way to also easily upgrade your Kubernetes cluster in a way with that you don't have any downtime of your workloads, as well as no downtime of the Kubernetes control plane. And it handles backup and disaster recovery for you. Of course, RKE also can be installed in a completely air-gapped environment where you don't have any internet connectivity at all. And on top of the basics, RKE also includes a lot of add-ons that are not directly part of Kubernetes, but that you need in any functioning Kubernetes environment. And it gives you a nice pre-choice of add-ons that are just there, they just work, they are completely directly managed by RKE automatically. That is, for example, etcd, the distributed storage that Kubernetes uses, but also networking plugins, internal DNS server, the container runtime, the ingress controller that takes the traffic from the outside and load balances it to the cluster inside, and also some tooling to get telemetry and metrics from your containers. So let's have a look how you can set up such an RKE cluster. What we have here is the RKE documentation. And basically, we are going to the installation quick starts now, which will give us a single node Kubernetes cluster. If you want to create a highly available cluster with multiple nodes, there are a couple more steps necessary than we are going to do in this short demo. But all the steps are described in tutorial style in the installation guidelines here, for example, under high availability. So let's have a look at our environment. And I'm starting here with one VM. It's a VM running that I prepared that's running on AWS. And in this case, it's running a SUSE Linux Enterprise Server 15SP2. Actually, the operating system is not very important for what we are doing because it would work the same way on any other modern Linux as well. In this case, it's a SUSE Linux. So let's start with the installation. First thing we have to do is we can run a small installation script. So here we are saying, hey, let's download the installation script and execute it. And basically, well, we of course have to do this as root. And basically what this script is doing, and you can have a look at it if you don't trust and don't want to execute something and pipe it into a root bash, which is perfectly valid. All it's doing, it's finding out what the latest RKE2 version is, in this case, 126. It downloads it and it extracts the tar file to user local. And the tar file in the end includes the RKE2 binary, two scripts to stop and uninstall RKE completely again, and one license and configuration file, and a systemd service. That's it. Now, next, we can actually start the systemd service. So let's first enable it so that this also persists during after reboots. And then let's start our RKE to systemd service. And now in the background, and we can also follow the logs here, RKE tool will start up the containerd container runtime. It will start pulling all the necessary container images for etcd, the Kubernetes control plane, and all add-ons. It will create certificates for a secure communication, and it will then start up all the different components. This is going to take like a minute or so. Let's cancel the logs here and let it run into the background. Once this cluster is up and running, we then can directly start interacting with that. And one way to interact with a Kubernetes cluster is with the standard Kubernetes command line tool called kubectl. I already have it installed here on my machine. I just installed it from the installation documents from the Kubernetes webpage. And if we now want to interact with our Kubernetes cluster, we have to tell kubectl where our Kubernetes cluster actually is and how it can authenticate against it. And for that, we need a standardized so-called kubeconfig file. And RKE2, when starting up, generates us such a kubeconfig file under etc rancher RKE2 RKE2.yaml. And this is what it looks like. It is a standardized file that tells us the location of the Kubernetes API, the CA certificate for secure communication, and how to authenticate at this Kubernetes API, in this case with a client certificate authentication. And I can take this kubeconfig file and give it to any tool that understands Kubernetes. And that can be, of course, kubectl, but that could also be a CI/CD tool that understands Kubernetes, like GitLab, your IDE, or security scanning tool, or any other Kubernetes tool that you can use. So, can for example say kubectl get nodes --kubeconfig and give it the path to this file. And we can see we have one node in our Kubernetes cluster, has been up since 33 seconds, and is in the process of getting ready. In order to not always passing or having to pass this kubeconfig argument, we can also export the path to this file into an environment variable. This is another option. And can say, hey, let's create a kubeconfig environment variable pointing to this file. And then we can just say kubectl get nodes, and we have a Kubernetes cluster. Great. And Kubernetes cluster are great. And if you have a couple of them, one, two, that's not a huge problem. You can do exactly what I did, probably in an HOA way, and you can maintain and upgrade these Kubernetes clusters. Upgrading is also as simple as installing it. But in a lot of environments, you not only have one or two Kubernetes clusters, you have multiple of them. You may have different environments, dev, staging, pre-prod, prod. You may have different teams, and you don't want to put all teams of all subsidiaries of your company into one single large cluster, maybe because of policies, because of access rights. You want to split this a bit apart. You also may have different hardware, and where you say, this machine learning stuff that needs GPUs, maybe I'm going to put this into its own cluster. You also may have different locations, and you may want to run some stuff on-premise in your data center, some stuff on the cloud, and have a hybrid setup, maybe also on different cloud providers to be not locked in. And maybe you even have edge devices where you say, I'm managing Kubernetes clusters in all my factories, and then you quickly not only have one or two Kubernetes clusters, but you have then quickly thousands of Kubernetes clusters. And if you need to manage all of them by hand, that's again very complicated. And that's where SUSE Rancher comes in. SUSE Rancher is a central Kubernetes management tool that you can use to manage everything from one to thousands of Kubernetes clusters, regardless on the infrastructure. These Kubernetes clusters can be in your data center, in the cloud, or in any kind of edge devices. And it also can be any kind of Kubernetes distribution, but you have tight integrations with RKE as a data center Kubernetes distribution and with our K3S as an edge Kubernetes distribution. And from the single central Rancher management interface, you can provision new clusters, you can upgrade them, but you can also set up all these day two operational tasks like authentication, role-based access control, monitoring, log shipping, service meshes, storage, security scans, backup and disaster recovery. And for all of that, Rancher directly has built-in integrations that you can just install with one click. And on top of that, you can also use the central Rancher management interface to manage the applications and containers that you are running inside of the clusters through an intuitive and central management interface, which is especially nice for the colleagues in development, for example, that want to see what is running inside of the cluster. Maybe they want to do an upgrade, but they are not expert on this Kubernetes API and don't know all of this YAML you saw out of the head. So let's see how you can actually install Rancher and what you can do with it. Let's switch to the other tab. And what I already prepared beforehand here is here I'm having a 3-node Kubernetes cluster. This is also an RKE2 cluster. I just created this beforehand before the presentation. What I also have already prepared is a load balancer that I put in front of this Kubernetes cluster that load balances all incoming traffic on port 80 and 443 and forwards it to one of my Kubernetes nodes, which will then go to the Ingress controller, which will then go to any kind of application. And I also already created a DNS entry that points to this load balancer. So let's have a look what we need to do to now install Rancher inside of this cluster, because Rancher in the end is a Kubernetes management tool, but also eat your own dog food. It's a workload that you install inside of Kubernetes. So Rancher itself makes use of the scalability and disaster recovery features and service discovery features that Kubernetes offers. And if we want to install Rancher inside of a Kubernetes cluster, we could, of course, now start writing our own deployments and our own YAML files to run Rancher. Or we could have a look and make ourselves easier by using a package manager. So similar in a Linux environment, you would probably not start compiling everything on your own. You use a package manager for it to help you. And the package manager for Kubernetes is called Helm. We'll put this one first. Helm is a package manager for Kubernetes that you can use to deploy predefined applications like Rancher into your Kubernetes cluster. And on top of that, you can then configure the individual things that you need directly to your liking. So yeah, let's start doing this. One thing to talk about beforehand, if before we install Rancher as a central management tool, is that Rancher offers us a management UI. And of course, this management UI also needs to be secured somehow. And needs to be secured with a TLS certificate, because it's a UI that we can use in our browser. There are now multiple ways to provide TLS certificates for Rancher when installing. We could buy a certificate for our DNS domain. We could create our own from our own corporate CA and then provide that to Rancher. But we also can automatically retrieve certificates through Let's Encrypt. And one way to interact with Let's Encrypt from a Kubernetes cluster is through a tool called Cert Manager that helps us with automating all of that and automatically retrieving certificates, automatically then also helping us with proving Let's Encrypt that the domain we are getting a certificate for is actually ours, and with automatically also renewing these certificates. And Cert Manager can also just be installed as a Helm chart. So in this case, we say, Helm, please install us from the JetStack repository an application called Cert Manager into a Kubernetes namespace, Cert Manager, in the version 1.3.1. And if we now have a look, we can see, hey, in our cluster, there is now Cert Manager running with its own small microservices. We don't have any certificates yet. We just created the tool that helps us retrieving that. And Rancher then, in turn, can automatically integrate with Cert Manager to get Let's Encrypt certificates. So now, if we install Rancher, we can say, Helm, please, let's maybe put this on the top. Helm, please install us Rancher from the Rancher latest repository into a namespace called Kettle System. In the version 2.5.7, please set the host name that the external host name, the DNS name, that I want to have a certificate for, and that also should be routed to the Rancher pods to rancher.playground.be. And please set the TLS certificate source to Let's Encrypt. And with that, when I install it, Rancher is now booting up, and we can now maybe follow this by saying, hey, watch kubectl get pods, ingresses, and certificates in the Kettle system namespace. And now we see our Helm chart installed through a Rancher deployment with three Rancher pods for high availability. We see our internal ingress routing rule that directs traffic coming in with this host name to these three pods here. And we can also see the reference for our TLS certificate that is currently being fetched from Let's Encrypt. And that one is already solved. Now we only have to wait until the Rancher pods are started, up and running, and healthy. And this should happen in a few seconds. And once this is done, we can go to our Rancher hostname. And this DNS entry is already created. It will then resolve to an external cloud load balancer in this case, which will then load balance to all of the three worker nodes. The traffic will then go to this Nginx ingress controller that sits on the edge of the cluster. And this ingress controller, based on this configuration, will forward the traffic to one of the up and running and healthy Rancher pods. This is actually all not Rancher specific. This is standard Kubernetes. So it would work the same way if you were to expose any other application to Kubernetes. You can do the same. You can create your deployment with your pods. You can create your ingress. You can fetch certificates and you are good to go. And the Rancher is in the end another Kubernetes native workload. While we are waiting here for the Rancher pods to start up and do the initial setups, I would like to point you to one more resource. What you can do if you want to continue now, maybe after SuSEcon, and continue trying it out on your own and learning, is you can go to our Rancher Academy. And this is something I very much recommend. It is an online learning platform that you can use to learn how to deploy RKE, how to deploy Rancher, and how to work with Kubernetes. It is free of charge, self-paced learning, and you even get a certificate afterwards. So I can highly recommend going to the Rancher Academy, and I will also provide the links to that at the end of the presentation. So now Rancher is up and running. So let's go now to our Rancher hostname. And we see the initial Rancher setup wizard. So we can provide an admin password, agree to the terms on services, also agree that the Rancher URL is the correct one. We get some information on what's new in Rancher 2.5. And now we have access to the Rancher central management UI that we can use now to, on the one hand, add additional clusters to it. So we can say we want to add additional clusters that already exist to Rancher, or maybe additional clusters on bare metal source or any kind of virtual machines. Or we can also say, hey, please Rancher, I want to create an additional cluster on a cloud provider, on a vSphere or other infrastructure providers through a plugin system. And then Rancher will directly integrate with this provider, boot up VMs based on a template where I can configure how much CPU and memory each VM gets, and install the container runtime and Kubernetes on it, and directly will bring it inside of the Rancher management. There are tons of more functionalities inside of Rancher to manage, as I said, your workloads, your clusters, set up authentication, authorization, monitoring, and there are multiple sessions at SuSEcon that I can recommend and that you should look out for that go into much more detail on the specific Rancher features. For this presentation, that was it. So we saw how to create an RKE to Kubernetes cluster. We saw how to install Rancher in it. And we saw then a bit of the Rancher interface, how you can add more clusters to it. Additional resources for that, I already said, have a look at the Rancher Academy, have a look at the RKE and Rancher docs, and also look out for our Rancher Rodeo webinars and interactive trainings that you can use to get more knowledge on Rancher and Kubernetes. And with that, thank you for attending the session and enjoy the rest of SuSEcon.